أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. Today inshallah we will touch upon some of the themes from chapter 74 المدثر, the enrobed. Now the main theme, the common theme of all the chapters in part 29 of the Quran is the importance of calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making da'wah. With all the examples given in the previous chapters of the qualities and methods to call to Allah and the knowledge of the greatness of the Creator, because that's what we're calling for, this chapter mobilizes the believers to spread the message and have patience. There is no time for rest as Judgment Day approaches. Da'wah is an obligation upon every believer in what they know and among who they know. So no one is, no one can say, it's not my responsibility. It's the responsibility of everyone in the amount of what you know and in the scope of who you know. If we look at the verses 1 and 2, the chapter starts, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها المدثر قم فأنذر. O you who covered himself with a garment, arise and warn. Now calling to Allah is an obligation. The state of being covered with garments could mean comfort and rest, like somebody who is, bundled in clothes on a cold night, just nice in bed and warm. That's rest, In this life, there is no time for rest for a believer because it's a preparation stage for the hereafter. There will be, eternity to enjoy and rest. But while we are, on this life, 30, 40, 50, 70, 80, 100, whatever time that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala gives us, we need to minimize the time of rest and focus on our obligations toward Allah and on calling others. The chapter is very clear. All you who wrapped yourself, get up. Get up and do something. Get up and warn of the impending hereafter, that's approaching, of the death that's approaching humans and the consequences that comes after it. We have to warn ourselves, our families, and others of that. It's our duty. وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ in verse 3, and your Lord glorify. That's what you're telling people, what you're warning people, what you're spreading, making da'wah about the greatness of Allah. Glorify Allah in thought and in action, and perfect the deeds and perfect the manners. Verses 4 and 5, وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ وَالرُّجْسَ فَهْجُرْ, and your clothing purify and uncleanliness avoid. So clothing is a metaphor for deeds that accompany and surround a person like clothes. So purify your physical clothes and also your soul from uncleanliness of disbelief and associating others with Allah, of shaky belief. Your belief has to be strong. وَلَا تَمْنُنْ تَسْتَكْثِرْ, and do not confer favor to acquire more. Do not call to Allah to get worldly gains. Do it for Allah's sake. And do not be satisfied that your da'wah is enough, or think that you are doing Allah a favor. Always do more and do it for the love and for the sake of Allah and for your love for humanity, because you want them to share, the rewards that Allah has, and warn them of the punishment that He has. Verse 7, وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ, but for your Lord be patient. You have to have patience, and only Allah can help you have that patience. And having patience for the sake of Allah, because you will face abuse and attacks when calling to Him. All deeds will stop when the trumpet is blown, signaling the beginning of the Day of Judgment. And that day is the happiest day for a believer, because it's the day to collect the reward of steadfastness and obedience. But it is a horrible day for the disbelievers, because they will realize that they have been on the opposite side of the truth all along, and that knowledge will not help them. And when Allah says it's a difficult day in this chapter, it is an unimaginable disaster. So Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala gives from his bounties, you know, from wealth and children and ease of life to everyone. But disbelievers are ungrateful to their Lord. And, you know, the verses kind of go, and in verse 16, Allah says, "Kalla innahu kana li'ayatina anida." No, indeed, he has been towards our verses obstinate. So on top of denying that all the favors that Allah gave them, they think that when they die, they're going to go to heaven. And the answer is kalla. No, not a chance. That is, it just because you had the good life in this life doesn't mean you're going to have the good life in the hereafter, especially if you did not believe in Allah and did not believe in the truth. And some of the mentions in this chapter was directed to Al-Mughira at the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He was one of the leaders of Quraysh, and he was very, very rich and had a lot of kids and a lot of money and a lot of wealth and status. And they thought just because they had that in this life, they don't have to believe in Allah. They're gonna have it in the hereafter. They didn't have to follow the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They did not have to accept the truth. And Allah says, no. They know indeed he has been towards our verses obstinate. When one rejects the Quran, he puts himself in grave danger of eternal punishment in hell. And the verses that follow warns that Allah will drive them into a place called Saqar. Sa'uslihi Saqar. Wama adraka ma Saqar. And how do you know what Saqar is? And Allah is going to tell us. La tubqi wa la tadhar. It lets nothing remain and leave nothing unburned. It burns everything down to the bones. لَوَّاحَةً لِلْبَشَرِ عَلَيْهَا 19. Blackening the skin, over it are 19 angels. Every instance of belittling the divine punishment or reward falls under these verses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threatening the deniers with a fire so hot that no one can imagine its intensity. It leaves nothing of the disbeliever but burns it to ashes. Then the body regenerates, and then the punishment continues for eternity. There is no rest, there is no reprieve, there is no death, and there is no end to the suffering. That is a horrible state to be in, that disbelief will get a person to that state. And it is the responsibility of a believer to call to Allah and to warn of this impending doom for the ones who would reject the message. And Allah mentions that the guardians of this hellfire, are 19 angels. Now, why did he say 19? We don't know. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that's out of his wisdom and out of his knowledge. But the key thing is, they are angels. Now, Abu Jahl joked at the time when this verse was revealed that he was an unbeliever. He was the head of the unbelievers. He said, well, 100, each 100 of us can take care of one of those angels. So, you know, don't worry. So he was telling his followers, don't worry. We're going to take those angels and we're going to hold them back so they can't, you know, take you to hellfire. I mean, such is the delusion and nonsense of disbelief. So as I said, the important thing is the guardians, the ones in charge of punishment, are angels. And what's the significance of it? If the guards were other human beings, they may have pity, they may feel, you know, mercy, but angels have no such feeling. They cannot be fought. They don't have mercy on disbelievers, and their allegiance is to Allah, and they will do whatever they are commanded to the letter, and they will never sway from it. So Allah is warning them that you will have no friends and no protectors and nobody to feel sorry for you, because those angels of punishment will do whatever Allah tells them, and that is a horrible state to we have to fear that. If we don't follow the truth. And then verses 32-35, كلا والقمر والليل إذ أدبر والصبح إذا أسفر إنها لإحدى الكبر. Allah swears by the moon and by the night when it departs and by the morning when it brightens. Indeed, the fire is of the greatest afflictions. So these arguments are mere delusions of the non-believers. What is not is hellfire as the greatest affliction. In verses 36 to 37, نَذِيرًا لِلْبَشَرِ لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ يَتَقَدَّمَ أَوْ يَتَأْخَرَ. So this fire is a warning to humanity, to whoever wills among you to proceed or stay behind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this fire as a deterrent to man to not disobey Allah. And Allah gave man the freedom to believe or not to believe, to proceed with good deeds or fall behind with sins. It is up to every one of us, and make, you know, you're supposed to make the best of it. And the pivotal verse, verse 38, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ رَهِينَ. Every soul for what it has earned will be retained. Man is a hostage to his deeds. If they were good, he will be honored. If his deeds were evil, he will be humiliated. So Islam advocates personal responsibility. If you are successful, it's because of your own deeds. Or if you are doomed, it's because of your own deeds. Don't blame anyone else. Don't say somebody else made me do it. It's you are responsible for your hereafter. If you want a good hereafter, straighten up. If you don't care, then you're going to find out. Verse 39 and to 42. إِلَّا أَصْحَابَ الْيَمِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ يَتَسَأَلُونَ عَنِ الْمُجْرِمِينَ مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرَ. So the ones protected from this end are the companions of the right, who will be in gardens questioning each other about the criminals and asking them, what got you into Saqar? Believers who do good deeds in this life will be rewarded with paradise. And in paradise, they'll wonder, they were people we knew, they were people among us, where are they? And they will look and they will see them in this horrible place in hellfire. And they will ask him, what got you there? What got you to this terrible place? So listen very carefully. So the following verses says, قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. They will say, and they will start enumerating what got them into that horrible place. The first one is, they were not of those who prayed, nor did we used to feed the poor, and we used to enter into vain discourse with those who engaged in it, and we used to deny the day of recompense until there come to us the certainty of death. So they did not establish a connection with Allah through prayers. They did not benefit others, and that's what zakat signifies. They blindly followed social trends and evil acts and did not think that they will ever be held accountable. But now that they see the truth, they know the truth, it is too late. It will not benefit. So belief at the time of death is worthless. So it is better to believe much earlier, when one can benefit from it. Because Allah says, فَمَا تَنْفَعُهُمْ شَفَاعَةُ الشَّافِعِينَ. So there will not benefit them the intercession of any intercessors. Then what's the matter with them that they run away from the reminder like they are alarmed donkeys fleeing from a lion? So the Prophet's intercession is only for ones who were steadfast and followed his example. For others, there is no such intercession. It is wishful thinking. You cannot go through this life disobeying Allah and counting on the Prophet's intercession in the hereafter. That's just silly. It is nonsense. You have to follow the example of the Prophet, and if you fall short, that's when the intercession of the Prophet, you know, comes to you. But if you knowingly disobey and then just kind of go through life hoping for the best, that is dangerous. And the imagery of the Quran is, these disbelievers run away from the truth like a zebra would run away from a lion. So if you know they don't want to listen to it, they don't want to hear it, they don't want anything to do with it, they run away when they start hearing it. It is for their benefit, but they choose not to benefit themselves. And in verse 52, Allah says, بَلْ يُرِيدُ كُلُّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمَا يُؤْتَى صُحُفًا مُنَشَّرَةً كَلَّا بَلْ لَا يَخَافُونَ الْآخِرَةِ. Rather, every person among them desires that he would be given scriptures spread about. No, but they do not fear the hereafter. So these disbelievers want a custom religion. custom religion that conforms to their whims and to their evil acts. They want to pray and drink. They want to fast and deal with usury. They want, you know, they want a pick and choose type of religion. Allah says no. You either follow all of it, or it won't benefit you. You have to follow it. And in verse 54, Allah says, "Kalla innahu tadhkira, faman sha'a dhakara." No, indeed, the Quran is a reminder. Then whoever wills will remember it. So that cannot be. You will never have the divine scriptures will never conform to your will. Your will has to conform to the scriptures, and it is a reminder. And the Quran is a reminder for whoever wants to remember. وَمَا يَذْكُرُونَ إِلَّا يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ وَأَهْلُ التَّقْوَى وَأَهْلُ الْمَغْفِرَةِ is the last verse 56. And they will not remember except that Allah wills. He is worthy of fear and adequate for granting forgiveness. And this verse requires a little bit of explanation. That Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala reminds man that he willed that man will have a free will. So the free will that we have is a bounty from Allah. He chose for us to have this free will to accept or reject the guidance. It should never be interpreted that Allah would force someone to accept the truth or not accept the truth. This aqidah, this creed of being forced into something is nonsense. Allah is saying because He willed that we have the free will, and it's up to us whether we accept or reject and pay the consequence or benefit from it. So the chapter ends with a reminder that only Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala should be feared, should be obeyed, placed hopes in, and seeking His protection, because He is the only one who is worthy of it. هو أهل التقوى وأهل المغفرة. And the last point is the name of the surah was Al-Muddathir, the enrobed, is a metaphor for rest. There is no rest for the believer. For a believer in this life, as it's a place of tests. This is not a place where you're going to put your feet up and enjoy your life and not have to work for something else. This life is a preparation for the hereafter. So the chapter reminds believers to strive to call others to Allah, to Allah and the truth in the Quran, and warn of the dire consequences of disobeying Him and denying His message. Subhanakallah wa bihamdik, la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah.